Hello, hello, everybody. It's me, Cheryl Grace, live from the Pink Couch. I am so thrilled to welcome you. Can you believe it? We're already at episode 5. We have these amazing women who have actually dedicated 5 weeks of their lives to being coached live in front of all of you with all the eyeballs watching and helping them get to their next level of what I call fabulosity as it relates to their career and how they are going to eat their pink elephants. Pink elephant is their most biggest audacious goals that they would like to accomplish as part of their career. And they are sharing those goals with us. We are giving them homework and we're giving them advice. And so as we do on almost every episode, what I love to do in addition to helping each of my hashtag next level tribe members, because you know they're going to the next level, what I like to do is I like to bring on experts who can help them get to that level. And we have with us an expert. I am going to tell you a little bit more about her. Her name is Tazeen. And she is an executive coach who specializes in HR, recruiting, talent management. She's experienced in helping clients identify their strengths and their weaknesses. And her clients have included professionals in IT, HR, marketing, and fashion, merchandising, and finance. So she is an all kind of ways coach who can help you regardless of the sector that you're in. She loves to tailor each professional's coaching program to their individual need. Now, we have 3 hashtag Next Level Tribe members with 3 very specific pink elephant goals. And this is our 4th coach. So clearly somebody's going to get coached again. Who's that person going to be? Drum roll, please. Vicky, our rising star. So let me take a rising star. A rising star is a person who is ready for that promotion, who's ready to move up. Her pink elephant goal is to land a director's role in HR and to also be an industry thought leader. But she wants to be promoted at her current company within the next year. So by May 2024. Earning $150,000 a year. That is her pink elephant goal. And I know there are a lot of you out there who want promotions. And so, yes, we're going to give Vicky some additional coaching. And that's what Tazeen Raza is here to do. And I am going to turn the screen over to these fabulous ladies so that Tazeen can coach Vicky. And we are going to put ourselves on mute, the rest of us. And then when we come back, I will introduce you to the other 2 wonderful hashtag Next Level Tribe members so that you can learn a little bit more about their pink elephant goals and what they've been working on since we met them last. Tazeen, welcome to the show.
Thank you so much, Cheryl. Great to be here.
So glad to have you. I'm going to turn things over to you and Vicky. Vicky, you're getting another chance of being coached. How's that feel?
I'm surprised. Yeah. I'm super excited and surprised. I'm stammering here. So this is cool. Thank you.
All right. Well, let the stammering begin with Tazeen. Tazeen, she's all yours. Vicky, awesome. Learn as much as you can. There you go.
So Vicky, I have so many questions for you. So many questions.
Awesome.
So I know that you have been in this last role for the last 10 years. So I've noticed on your resume that you've done so many different things in HR, multifaceted, but going from where you are to director, that's a big jump in any field, but you know, as well as I do in HR, that's the biggest jump, right? It takes the longest time. So taking, 10 years to get there, that's a good amount of time. So, not too worried about that. But my question to you is, I see that you have a lot of experience in every sector. You have the HRBP experience, you have the recruiting experience, you have the compensation experience, but what about L&D? Is learning and development something that's on your radar to do to make you a full 360 around?
So the answer is yes and no. Learning and development is something that's popping up. When I think about the work that I do within my current role as a senior HR business partner, the mm-hmm. things that I get most excited about tend to be learning and development leaning, for sure. My challenge is that I enjoy being a generalist, meaning having my hands in a little bit of everything. And the idea of being a specialist in something is a little scary and exciting at the same time. But mm-hmm. I will tell you that the things that I really lean into the most and get excited about within my role in a generalist capacity is the learning and development work.
I think that that would really help kind of make you more multifaceted, because there have been so many people that I've seen very similar to you, and they are like, oh, while I've done all of this, why can't I now go to the next level to be director? Because when you're managing people, and that's what director is, right? You're managing all of these people. It's not just your population. It's not just people that are reporting that are, you know, part of the people that you're managing in those managers. No, you also have direct reports. Their direct reports have direct reports. So I think having that learning and development background for you, like even if it's just, you know, a short stint, okay, I want to do this solely for, I don't know, 6 months, do it solely for, you know, I don't know, a very short amount of time, because learning and development solely will get old. It's not for you, for sure. Because when you're a generalist and you're going to be that specialist, it's very difficult to do, because, you know, I was an HRBP myself, and I know, like, there, no 2 days are the same. Everything is always crazy. And that's what we love. That's what the passion is for us.
We love the crazy.
Exactly. So going into learning and development solely will be very tough for you. But I think that this is something you have to do to give yourself that full rounded exposure. And then you can say, hey, I've done all of these things. I'm ready to manage all of these people in any of these sections, because this is what I've done. You can't say that you're ready to manage all of these people when you haven't fully encompassed everything. So there's been a lot of people that have been similar that don't have that one exposure. Soon as they get that one exposure, they're back in it, and they're ready to become director. Because if I'm looking at you on paper, I mean, you're not on paper here, but on paper, I'm looking at you on paper, I see that you have everything. You have that recruiting. You started out, you know, as just a representative. So now with all of the exposures that you've had, and you have years in industry experience, there is no reason why you can't get promoted. Zero. That is the only one thing I think that is holding you back a little bit, that learning and development piece, because that's just the one thing that I don't see on here. It's just that small difference of managing people versus just managing, you know, my own population and managing what I'm doing. You're managing so much more, and you're ready to take that on. But I think that piece is going to put you over the edge for sure.
I'm interested in your perspective, because HR is a super broad field.
Yeah.
And there are specialties within it. I've been primarily in a generalist capacity for the bulk of my HR career. Mm-hmm. So would you recommend the same thing for benefits and systems, or what are you seeing as the added benefit to kind of having that?
Well, you have the compensation part of it. You know, you did that already, the payroll benefits and information systems. You have enough. And plus, don't forget, you also have SHRM certificate. You also have your PHR. Those things together, you don't really need that. The learning and development piece is just the one thing that I don't see on here, on your resume even. Mm-hmm. I don't see it. And I'm looking, I'm like, where's the rest? That's just the one piece that I don't, everything else, you've hit every nail. Payroll and benefits, legal communications, training and development, slight, right. Teams, you know, you're doing your own company training, that's fine. But when you're leading, like, you know, let's say for just a very wide example, when you're doing a class, right? Let's say you're teaching a class, or you teach a new series of classes that help people, I don't know, with systems access or something, mm-hmm. right? Then you're starting to learn not just what people's problems are as an HRBP. You're learning, hey, this is a way that someone learns. Oh, this person doesn't learn this way. Let me change my viewpoint. Let me change my way of delivering so I can help this person. And then that in turn helps you become to that director level, because no two people learn the same. And in you, you know, you'll have those people that you're like, this person's so smart. Why don't they get it? And you will have to pivot and change and turn. And I think that learning and development piece will help you get to that, because you're seeing this from a different perspective. And as an HRBP, we don't see that. What learning and development gives to us, it opens our mind in a different way that HRBP kind of doesn't. It doesn't, like we're too engrossed in the trenches, so to say, to kind of see that bigger perspective. And that's why I think that you need that, even though I know you won't like it for that long. I can tell you that. You'll be like, I'm out of here. But I think that for a short time, I think that it would be beneficial for you to do. And then, you know, at that point, if you're still not ready for promotion, this company, Acosta, is still not giving it to you, I'm afraid you're going to have to say bye-bye. Like that's it. You know, like it's time to look elsewhere then at that point, because you've done everything on your end. You've tried to, you know, encompass everything and trying to learn all of those things. And sometimes, you know, having a class maybe just on that learning development piece might even be all you need. You might not even need to be doing it for that long, like a class for, you know, a session. I mean, a month or two or whatever, however long those classes are, like, you know, a college course or whatever. I had a bunch of people that did that and actually helped them kind of get them over the edge. Yes, it wasn't to a director level role, but you know, something, just some ideas that you can kind of brainstorm that would help you.
No, I what you're saying is clicking with me, because I do want to be an effective HR business partner. And I think if there was an opportunity for me to do special projects within talent development, mm-hmm. or to your point, a small stint, I think it would make me, to your point, a more rounded HR business partner. And I could provide the level of coaching and support that I long to provide to the leaders that I support and leaders and managers that I support. I've talked with Cheryl about a coaching certification. Mm-hmm. I'm still, you know, open to that, still wanting to do that. Mm-hmm. But I think if I could pair that with a stint in learning and development or a special project within that group, I think that would be a huge benefit to me being a more impactful business partner and certainly on my way to a director role.
Yeah. I mean, I think you'd be great at like just even teaching a class, or, you know, it doesn't have to be like, oh, I'm doing this full time. You know, you do teach one or two classes throughout the day and then do your regular HRBP. Yes, it's going to be super hard because HRBP is like a two people job, you know, like one population is like too much. So, but yeah, I mean, I think that perspective for you will really help. And then, you know, the other thing that I noticed on your resume and skills and software, you didn't really have too many HR things on there. Like I wanted to see more about your HR stuff. So yes, you said self-starter, problem solving. These are generic things that people can have for any field. Mm-hmm. I want to see more specific compensation and benefits, you know, payroll management. Like those are the things that for you, that's what I want to see there. Because HR resumes are so different than, you know, our resumes. Like all other resumes are very different from what you have here. So I would want to see a little bit more, or if you use PeopleSoft, if you use whatever program that is used that in your HR, then, you know, that's something that you can put there as well. And that is another thing that I don't see there. And I know that is a specialized program that's very difficult to use. Visio, for example, to make those org charts. That's a very niche, you know, thing. Nobody knows how to use those. That's very difficult. So, I mean, that's something that you can, if you know how to do those things, absolutely. That's what I want to see on there. You know, 8 to 10 of those just HR skills. Like this resume is not a generic resume. You're an HR director. I want to see that on there.
It's so funny because these are just things that you do on a regular basis. You don't think about the specifics or the specialness of it. So I don't even think to put those on my resume because it's just the nature of the work that I do.
Exactly.
So to your point, I definitely need to ramp up and add some of those hard soft skills to the resume, if you will. LinkedIn.
HR people are the most difficult people to do their own resumes. Like you will be like, why did, like, this is so, you know, but we are so tough on ourselves. Like we don't really know kind of how to do it. That's why whenever you have your resume and you have another HR person look at, they'll see things that you didn't see. Yep. Oh, okay. You know, this is what, I'm noticing this here. Is this what you meant? Or is this what you meant? So it's nice that you have all of those things there. I mean, I think in general, I think that your resume was great and that, you know, if I was hiring a director, I would hire you. But, you know, I think that those adding those perspectives in there, I think will help. And then same with this position that you had. You worked at Albertsons before, right? HR in Albertsons, and then the rest of this was at Acosta. Mm-hmm. The last 10 years. Okay.
Yes.
So yeah, I mean, that's the only thing that I would, in terms of your resume, change. But I think that you're on your way up. And I think that if you just did some of those things, so some of those things that we kind of don't want to do, but, you know, I think that that will kind of help you get to where you want to go and get there faster. You've already dedicated 10 years here. So, you know, due time, just now.
So I want to jump in here because I've got a couple of questions, Vicky, that maybe we can ask so that you get clarity on it, because Tazeen, you raised some excellent points. Sometimes, and this is a Cheryl's Pink Couch tip, sometimes you have to go in order to grow. And so you suggested if after she does a couple of these other things and the company still opts not to promote her, within a reasonable amount of time, A, what's the reasonable amount of time? And B, how does Vicky set herself up to pivot forward outside of the company?
Such a good question, Cheryl, because like I said, going from where she is to director, that takes time. Generally, I would say if you don't get promoted from 6 to 7, 8 years, you got to go immediately. But she's going to director, so director generally 8 to 10 is fine, but after that she cannot make it to 11. Like she cannot. I refuse to let Vicky stay there for 11 years. She cannot stay there that long, but that is kind of the threshold, right? If she's approaching that, you know, 11 years and she's still seeing that there's no movement happening, you see things. And as an HR professional, Vicky knows what's up. She's gonna see in the background all this is happening and this is kind of what I'm seeing. And oh, maybe they're getting ready for some kind of promotion. She's going to know that 6 months down the line, right as it's coming up, she's going to see that they're trying to make room for that. And if she doesn't see that, she needs to start looking elsewhere. And obviously you never leave without a job. You don't go free. No. You got to get a job and then leave. And then, you know, not just one job, you got to get 1, 2, 3 offers and then pick the best one. And that ideally would be what Vicky would do. And if she really wanted to stay, oh, I love Acosta, I love staying here. Okay, great. That's great, Vicky. But now you have all these 3 offers. Take those 3 offers, take that best offer and say, hey, I'm getting this offer. What can you give me? You know?
Okay. So you just shared a whole bunch. Vicky, before I ask my questions, you want to jump in with any of your questions first?
I want to clarify the role that I'm in now is a senior HR business partner, and I've had that role for not quite a year yet. I've been with my organization for 10 years last month, and in the last 2 years, I've seen quite some movement from a career perspective. So I don't know that the resume that I've shared is the most current. Actually, it's not. To your point about HR people being their worst person, I've not updated my resume. So I want to just provide some clarity on that.
Okay. So your last senior VP role is you've been there for 3 years, 2 years.
Correct.
Okay.
I heard you say to her, now is, okay, so if a year is her deadline for herself, we need to start like 6 months from now, asking and prepping to either grow or get to step in. Yes.
Well, because she's already at 2 years now, right? She's been at the company for 10. She's been in the current role for 2. So by the time it's her third year, she got to see some movement. Otherwise, you know, I mean, I will say that I generally give it 4 to 5. And this is a big step. And I think that's fine. But if you're not seeing any movement, there are no positions opening up, they're putting hiring freezes, you know what the signs are, then you have to be honest with yourself and say, hey, I don't think that this is going to work. I don't see any of those signs. I think I'm going to have to be real with myself and then start looking elsewhere. But I think that you do have a year to 2 years based on this new information that I've been given. 1 to 2 years to prep yourself for that, you know, and then if you don't see anything, then because you're still pretty new at this role, 2 years, you're just getting used to it. Give yourself a year, then you're mastering it, right? And then in that, the next year, if you're not seeing anything, bye-bye, gotta go.
If I could ask you this level of mastery, because I probably am my own worst enemy with wanting to know all the things, and we're continuously evolving, we're ever growing, you know, there's never going to be a point where you know everything.
Yeah.
So for someone who is looking to advance, kind of what are your thoughts on knowing enough to go to the next level, if that question makes sense? I don't want to put myself in a box where I have to just know everything or attempt to know everything before I can raise my hand to go on to the next level. What's kind of your gut or your sense on where someone can be before opening themselves up to being considered for the next role?
I think that you yourself will feel it. You know, like this is not something a third or fourth person that's watching mm-hmm. can say, oh, she's ready. You yourself will feel it in your gut. Hey, you know, I'm feeling comfortable with what I do. I know that no 2 days are the same, but hey, I know generally this is what I'm expecting. This is looking like this. You know, in when it's a crisis, right? In HR, there's crisis daily. You know when there's a crisis and you've handled it in the way that is, you've gotten a pat on the back from your superiors. Hey, wow, okay, I didn't really think that I did that well, but okay, this is what, you know, so it's not just you, how you see yourself, but how everybody's also seeing you. And then you feel it in yourself, like, hey, I think I have mastered or am ready for that next step up, because you feel comfortable giving those advices to other people who are asking you questions. First of all, you feel comfortable handling those crises on your own. Let's say your director isn't there and you're the person in charge. Do you feel comfortable with making the call that you're making? If yes, great. That means you are confident and you're ready to go on to that next level. If you're still like, okay, well, I don't know. Is this the right? Like, everybody questions themselves daily. Everyone does it daily. It's just that when you're ready for that level of role, and I can see you right away, like I clocked you, I know who you are, you're going to know it in yourself. You're your own worst enemy, and you kind of judge yourself. And that is, you are hindering yourself. That is the thing. You just have to feel it in yourself and just be like, okay, I mean, I'm seeing this, I'm doing the right things, I'm making the calls that I'm comfortable with. Now, you know, 2 years in, I'm ready to take on to that next stage. Who doesn't want to be director right away, right? But I think once you're ready and you've mastered this role, you yourself will say, I'm ready for that.
I have to agree. I think Vicky having a checklist also of some of the areas that have been called out that may mm-hmm. be gaps, not huge gaps, but slight gaps, right? And how can you take advantage of your time in your current role
to close those gaps. And so Kazeen has talked about the gap in development and leadership and development. And I'm wondering if your company has a employee resource group or business resource group, because that would be a great way to get involved to teach something and get some of that experience, right, Tazine? Is that?
Absolutely. I love that idea, because then she has that exposure. Hey, I've done this and this is my learning from that.
Yeah. No, and I also think that if she, you know, ask to shadow people who do, what some of these gaps may present to themselves, to get her current manager's buy-in on helping to fill in some of these gaps. And I know that a lot of clients tend to hesitate in terms of asking their boss, what do you think I could do during the next 8 months to strengthen my chances of being promoted to XYZ?
Yeah.
And lean into that as well as what to what Kazeen is saying too.
Yeah, and I think she needs to have a development plan for herself. In the next 6 months, I see myself here. In the next year, because again, we are our worst people. We never make development plans for ourselves. And why the hell not? We should. You know, make a development plan for yourself. 6 months, I'm here. This is, and obviously you can't hold yourself to a very stringent, you know, it has to be fluid. Everything's fluid. But 6 months, I see myself here, in a year here, 5 years here. You have to make that plan for yourself, because this is not your boss's job. This is your job to show your boss, this is my plan for myself. How can you support me to get me there? Where do you see my areas of improvement are? Give me feedback so I can grow. And that in itself is a learning on its own. That's a growing part on your own. Wow, Vicky, she's really great at taking feedback. Wow, she's really great at, you know, doing all these things. She wasn't good at this, but now, have you noticed this about her? She's gotten so much better at this. And these are the things that you yourself will notice, but other people will too. And that's how you'll know.
Excellent advice. Excellent. Thank you so much for sharing your wisdom. Vicky, do you have any questions before we let her go?
No, this has been super helpful, Tazeen. Thank you so much. Thank you, Cheryl. Good stuff. Awesome. I got some good notes.
Thank you so much.
Yes. Tazeen, thank you so much. I will send you all of the details on when we have the post-production all ready for you.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Cheryl. Bye.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Those were really some excellent, excellent nuggets that Tazeen shared, Vicky. And also, you know, I see other two, Deshira, Destiny. There is some information that she shared that you guys can certainly lean into as well. One of the coach's pink couch tips that Tazeen shared was lean into asking for feedback. And so often we shy away from feedback. We're afraid of what is going to be said, and we shouldn't be running from it. We should be running toward feedback. The more feedback, the better. The way to accept feedback is to always say thank you. And you keep the information, the feedback, the criticism, the praise that you feel is warranted. You can push aside anything that you feel really isn't. But if you keep hearing the same type of feedback from different sources and you're the common denominator, pay attention to that as well. So again, you know, her pink couch tip is to lean into the feedback. I also heard Tazeen say, have a fluid development plan for yourself. And again, that's something all three of you should be exercising. Destiny, you're just starting out. Well, where do you want to be a year from now? And that's why we set these pink couch goals. Deshira, we want to talk about where you see yourself after passing the CPA exam and all the things that have to happen, being fluent and intentional. So that's our word for the day again. And I know we've had this word before. And if that word intentionality is not seared in your brains, ladies, I want you to sear it into your brains. Intentionality. Act with intention. Be purposeful about everything that you do, because it is how you get from step one to step two to step 152. So Vicki, you had some other homework, and before we let you go, tell me if you've had an opportunity to, I think you've already met with your other one-on-one coach, correct?
I did.
How was it?
I met with Alicia, and that was a fabulous session. She gave me some ideas about how to use internal resources to help me along the way. It's amazing how you overlook some of the offerings that are already available to you within your own company. So she gave me some ideas on how to use what I have to help create my pitch for a coaching environment when I get ready to do that. She gave me, even though I had set myself on a path towards a particular coaching certification, she kind of gave me some thoughts and ideas to not dissuade me, but just kind of rethink and be open to other ideas. So great conversation. She and I connected on LinkedIn also, and she's going to send me some of her tools that she used to help shape her career and get her to the next step. She's awesome.
Great. So Alicia was the coach that we set you up with the last time I think we were here. So great to know that you guys connected one-on-one.
Yep.
Not the last time, time before, episode
three.
One of the episodes three. Thank you. And then your homework assignments. So the last time we spoke, you had written a 400 word blog, if you will. Tell me about what you did differently as you went back and reviewed it, why you did it, and where we are now with it.
So my original version was written from the point of me. It was like a journal entry, if you will. So as I think about putting something out there on the web, who do I want to connect with? Who do I want to resonate with? And I go back to other HR business partners, other HR generalists, meaning if we're in a society where folks want to have catered career development plans, curated development plans, how can we as business partners help them with their development plans? What kind of tools are available to us? What kind of scenarios do we want to role play? What kind of language do we want to use to be more effective, more impactful in our roles to help our leaders, our business partners be successful in their roles? The developing piece, coaching them along their career paths. Part of our role as business partners is helping people develop career paths with creating roles, compensation plans, et cetera. So how do we help our business partners get to those next levels? How do we help them grow? So I'm thinking about my journey and my blog post. The audience that I have in mind are other HR business partners. How can we rally together? What can we glean from each other to help us be more impactful in our roles, to help our partners be bigger than what they already are, grow in their careers, grow in their roles?
So it's wonderful you identified a target audience. You all always keep a target audience in mind anytime you're writing anything, anything. I don't care if it's an email. I don't care if it is a blog post. I don't care if it is a comment or a post on your social media profile. Who are you talking to? And write it from the perspective that they will be able to relate when they read it. So, you know, you're talking to professionals who are generalists in HR. So you're not talking to new graduates right out of college, or you're not talking to people who are about to retire. So how you use words in the language to speak directly to that avatar is really very critical, you all, because then people are going to feel like, have y'all ever been in church and you felt like the minister was talking directly to you about your sins? What?
and you start to slide down in your chair, right? He's not really talking to you, but he's talking to people like you who have had similar experiences, who have guilt running through their mind from something else. So it feels like he's talking to you. And that's what you want when you are writing. You want to make sure that the person that you are connecting with feels like you're talking to them. Oh my God, she gets me. She totally gets me. That's what you want to go for. So great. So the next step before, since this is our next to last episode, so before we get out of here, and in this season four, I want you to publish that somewhere. You choose the platform. So your homework assignment is to publish it between now and next time we meet. So I will take a look at it again, if you would like me to, and give you any feedback. I will do that, but I need you to publish it before we go live next time so we can talk about how it felt to hit the button or to hit the send button. And if you got any feedback and what the feedback was, and also just making sure, this is the other thing that I really want you to do. So there are two homework assignments. Is if you haven't already gone in and connected with additional HR generalists on LinkedIn, do that. And you can also let them know, I'm going to post about this topic. So get people engaged in areas that are important to you. So those are your two homework assignments. You're going to hit publish. Before you hit publish, go in and identify some other HR generalists or HR folks who fit that avatar and connect with them and let them know that you're going to be publishing an article or a post. Didn't have to be an article. Okay.
Okay.
How are you feeling about all that?
I'm hitting that send button. It's like hitting send on an email. You're just kind of hovering over it with a shaking finger, but no, we'll do it.
Kiss it and let it go. Set it free. Set it free. You're on your way. Thank you, Vicky. Thank you for being brave enough to go through this twice. Deshira, hello. Okay, so Deshira, you and I communicated a little bit. You had your big first exam. You got the results back. Tell us what happened and how you're feeling and what's going on.
It took me a while to understand how they post the score. So when I saw it, I was disappointed, but wasn't feeling too bad. So I just started studying all over again.
So you didn't pass?
No, I didn't. Mm-mm.
Okay. We're sorry, first of all, that you did not pass.
Thank you. That's okay. So I started my new study routine, and then I am thinking about purchasing another study material. I don't know. We'll see.
Okay. So I love that, and I don't know if it's just because we're on camera or if this is just the way you are in general, but I love your attitude about, okay, I didn't pass, but I'm not giving up. So, you know, there are a number of tips that I'd like to kind of share about how to handle disappointment. I think, Destiny, it was you early on in one of our episodes, I said, disappointments are going to happen. Failure is going to happen. I don't know if you recall me saying that, but it happens to all of us. It doesn't matter where we are in our career. We're always going to experience setbacks. I don't want to call it failure as much as I want to call it setback, but everything that we experience is to teach us something. So is there anything that you would say you learned from taking your first exam, Deshira?
Not wanting to give up and staying in my, I think my motivation too comes from the support group that I'm in. I just feel like I'm not alone because a lot of people will share, hey, I didn't pass, but let's start from here, let's get together. Or they'll post stuff that's in their study material and try to understand it from another person's perspective. Like the, how you say her name? Tyza was saying, some people learn different when you-
Tazine, yeah.
So that's basically, that support group helps me. Cause I know I'm not alone. I know I'm not a failure, or it's just gonna happen when it's my time, I guess.
Okay, very good. I think, you know, mindset, and this is a Cheryl's pink couch tip for you and everybody else out there. Mindset is so important. And I've talked to you all before about mindset. It's how I always start my coaching sessions. When I coach individuals, when I coach teams of people, I really focus in on mindset. And it's important to have a growth versus fixed mindset. A growth mindset is one that believes that everything that happens to me happens for me. Okay? It happens for me. So there's a reason that I am going to have to take this test again. Sometimes we can't see it until years down the line, right? Like I always say, if I had married some of the men that I had dated and who broke my heart, like I'd be a widow a couple of times. I'd be like taking people to, dialysis. Like there would be things I would be experiencing that I don't really want to experience. So glad that I went through the broken heart phase. Because I think I got protected from some of the other things that I could have been exposed to. So sometimes rejection is God's protection. That being said, a growth mindset is a mindset that focuses on how do I take this experience and learn from it. So one of the tips that I would like to share, there are like three tips. Tip number one is to have a growth mindset versus a fixed mindset. That fixed mindset is, woe is me, this happened, nothing I could do about it, shrug my shoulders, don't want to try again, life just isn't fair. That's a fixed mindset. A growth mindset is, okay, didn't pass this one, what did I learn from it? What do I need to do to pass it the next time? The second thing is, you know, understand how does your setback impact your goal? So when we originally started, your pink elephant goal is you're about to retire in a few months, and you want to be a certified public accountant. So you have to take the test and you have 18 months to take it after the first one. Am I getting that right?
After I pass the first one.
After you pass the first one. So our clock literally can't start ticking mm-hmm. until you pass that first one. Mm-hmm. So how does a setback impact your goal? Like when can you take the test again?
As soon as I pay the fee again, I have to go through that process and then just schedule whatever is available when I can go.
Okay. So you're going to, let's just be real. When are you going to try to take it again?
So because I dropped my kids off, my parents took them for the summer. I'm going to set that goal for the end of July.
Happy dance. Happy dance. We're doing a happy dance. We're doing like, you know, celebration, right? No kids for the summer. No kids for the summer. That's great. Just teasing. We love all you kids out there. But it gives you time to just focus on what's important and getting, you know, whatever you didn't get right or whatever you feel you need to do differently on the next exam. This gives you time to do that. And so what adjustments do you think you need to make, or what can you do differently? Those are questions that we need to ask ourselves after a setback. What adjustments do you need to make, and what can you do differently this time around?
So definitely because too, I didn't make promotion in the military this past month because it comes out the same time that I had my results. That literally pushed me even harder to start waking up at 5, because that's what I do now. I study in the morning time versus studying at night on the weekdays. And then that way on the weekends, I have more time to just add to what I've already done throughout Monday through Friday. So
okay,
that pushed me a lot. Not making rank, like she said, if you're not going anywhere, it's time to go. So my mind is really focused on understanding material, focusing on my routine and trying to knock it out by the end of July.
Kishira, are there sample tests that you can take?
Yes, there is.
Okay. And so you're taking those?
Yes. And I have a book. Like it's a book of questions and simulations inside the book. I just haven't picked it up because I want to make sure I understand all the material in the other book first.
So this is a new book. You have a new book?
No, it's the same book. I just never opened it because when I was in that support group, a lot of people said, I didn't even touch that book. I just read the material in the first book.
Okay, so this time what you're going to do differently is you're going to touch the book.
Right.
Okay, so we're going to open the book. So that's one of the things we're doing differently. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I love that it caused you to dig in your heels mm-hmm. even more. And Tazeem said it, right? Like you can recognize the signs. So if you're not going up, y'all got to get out, get to stepping and step on your own terms. I think that's really important, is for you to step on your own terms. One of the other things that I will say, and you have probably already passed this phase, but is to set a morning as in M-O-U-R-N-I-N-G, pity party period. All right. So the three P's, PPP, pity party period. I don't want anybody to ever like wash over how they're feeling emotionally after a setback. I want you to take the time to reflect on how this setback made you feel. You can cry, you can wallow, you can scream, you can wail, but you only do it for a set period of time. Right. Mm-hmm. And I'm talking like maybe 24 hours a week at the most. Anything beyond that moves into depression. So set a pity party period of time to get the emotional stuff out of your system and then get back to work. That is really very important. Like when that time is over, you wipe your eyes, you get up and you begin again. Fall down 7 times, get up 8. And you want to do it with a renewed vigor and a slightly different approach. So insanity, as we all know, is doing the same thing over and over again and expecting different results. So that's why I want you to ask yourself, what adjustments do you need to make? What can you do differently? You know, making sure that you get some clarity and answers on those questions before you just dive back in. Does that make sense? I also think it's important for you to focus on how you feel about the setback, not how you think others feel about the setback. Mm-hmm. Sometimes we put so much emotion and attention on, oh my God, people are going to think I'm this or that because I didn't do this or that. Or sometimes we think people are laughing at me, or I've humiliated myself. Get over all of that. Every single person has a setback in their life. So I want you to focus on what it means to you. And then again, doing that from a growth mindset. Okay, so we're going to take the test in July. All right. Tell me, you had some other homework assignments. Did you have a chance to talk back on a one-on-one with your coach?
Yes, I did. We spoke.
Okay. So what was that like? What did you learn?
It was awesome advice again. She went more in depth. So I was able to get some stuff changed. However, I'm not finished because since I'm doing a resume, I haven't done one in so long. I don't really need it, but I'm definitely using the tools that she gave me that day because she took an extensive amount of time I think it was like 45 minutes to an hour we were on there. So
wow, yeah. So yeah, so you should get that done, even though you don't need it now. The best time, this is a Cheryl's Pink Couch tip, but the best time to prepare for war is when you're at peace. So you want to make sure you get your resume done and you get it done. I'd like to have you done, have it done before we end our web series. Because okay. I want to know that you're all taken care of, Deshira. I want to make sure that you've got that out of the way, that you don't keep pushing that off because you think you don't need it. Just get it done and put it up on, you know, your LinkedIn profile or whatever, but just get it done so that you, what's the phrase that the kids say? If you stay ready, you don't have to get ready.
Yeah.
Understood. So I want you to be ready. Yeah. So don't keep pushing it off. Like one of those days where you set aside for studying, the kids are gone now, dig in and work on that resume and put those tips that Kelly Butler, your executive coach, shared with you, put those to work for you. Okay. What else do we need to talk about with you?
I think that was it. I met with the two people that were already a CPA. That was
That's
nice.
Right. How was that? What did you learn?
I learned a lot. They gave some
good... one thing, what takeaway would you say you learned? I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt.
Just to keep going. Like that's, they were motivating me as well, just to keep going. Don't give up. And I do like the jobs that they had. So, and like I said, the accounting field, it has so many opportunities and different career paths. That's what I love about it. So it was awesome.
And were these people from the companies that you identified? Because one of your homework assignments was to identify companies that you'd like to work at. And were the folks that you identified to talk to, were they from any of the companies on your list?
No, the other one, actually, yes, the first one, yes, she does work for Deloitte.
Okay. Oh, good.
Yeah.
Good. Well, very good. And I know that we had talked a little bit earlier too about how do you talk to people who are more senior than you. It was one of the concerns that we talked about on our last session. And how to handle that. So did you have any hesitancy when you talked to your folks that you reached out to for the informational interviews?
Oh, no, because they were very like willing to answer any question I had. So that was very a humbling experience, I guess. I don't know. They answered everything that I wanted to know.
Good. Okay. So I did look up some suggestions and tips for you all, because I know it was something that everybody here on the call could want to do, about how do you talk to somebody who is important, right? I'm not going to say more important than you, because we're all important and everybody puts their pants on the same way, or their skirts or their dresses, whatever they're wearing. But really talking to anybody new, the best way I've found is by asking questions, open-ended questions. So not like, is this your first time here? That's a yes or no question. That's a closed-ended question. Ask open-ended questions. How often do you attend these events? Or how long have you worked with Deloitte & Touche? Or how long have you been with the company? What would you say you've learned the most since you've been in a CPA role? Ask open-ended questions, and that gets people to talking. People love to talk about themselves. They really do. And it is an easy way. Making sure that you're approaching someone who feels like they are worth your time, Like, don't take all that nervous energy and put it on somebody who can't really help you, right? Focus that nervous energy on somebody who has the power to make decisions or the power to introduce you to someone who can make those decisions. That's really important, is identifying who you want to reach out to and talk to. And then I think also just keeping it simple. And when you run out of things to say, it's been great talking with you in the conversation. I'd love to talk all night, but I don't want to hog up your time. It's been great talking with you, or thank you if it's over the phone or if it's like this on a Zoom call. Thank you for taking time out to talk with me. I've learned a lot. I'd love to keep the channels of communication open. And then, because you just said that, I'd love to keep the channel of communications open. I want y'all to keep the channels of communications open. That means I want you to send a follow-up thank you note. I want you to send them something, if you've picked up out of this conversation, something of interest to them, and you see something about that topic included in a news article or a magazine article, cut it out and send it to that person, or take a picture of it and send it to that person and say, was just thinking about you, thought you would find this interesting. You don't need a long email, but keep those lines of communications open. Cheryl's Pink Couch Tip, if I could do it all over again, I would do a much better job of having kept up with people from my past. I really would. And so while you guys have all this time looming ahead of you, make it a point now of finding a way to keep up with people. It's easier now that you have social media, but you still have to be, what's the word? Intentional. That's right, Vicki. It's intentional. Right. Okay. Any other questions? No. All right, Deshira. So we are going to spend this next week getting that resume up and complete it. Send it to me or let me know that you got it done so I can take a look at it before our last class. Okay.
Understood. Yeah. Will do.
That's your very important homework assignment. Okay. And now, Destiny, I see you over there just sneezing up a storm. Destiny is our newbie, and Destiny is a recent college graduate. She is looking to go into the real estate industry. She wants to be an entrepreneur. She wants to make between $80,000 and $100,000. Her first year working at a Southern Florida accounting agency. So Destiny, you had the homework assignment of reaching out to individuals that you admire in, you had to choose. One of your homework assignments was choosing five corporations you'd like to work for and five real estate agencies that you'd like to work for. Tell me where you are and what's been happening.
All right, Cheryl. So I actually have reached out to the five real estate agencies yet. I have not heard back from not one of them yet. And I'm now second guessing probably what I probably said in my email. Because my subject of the email was introducing myself. And I just kindly introduced myself. I said, hello, my name is Destiny Warner Vincent. I'm a recent college graduate. And then I just talked a little bit about myself. I even incorporated a little bit of my own personal research from their company. And I incorporated a little bit of that just briefly because I wanted to make the email brief so that I didn't take up too much of their time. And then I closed the email by saying that I thank you in advance for your time and attention to this email. But I have not heard a reply back. And I also have not sent a follow-up, which is probably due time for that.
Okay, so first of all, we're gonna do a happy dance because you got those out. Happy dance, yeah. Come on everybody. Let's happy dance. Okay, so you got it out. Congratulations, because that's hard. That is hard. That takes a lot of nerve. How did you feel?
Yeah, I took a lot of thinking and a lot of my time too, because I wanted to make sure that I wasn't saying the wrong things. I also wanted to make sure I was grammatically correct. I wanted to make sure that my structure of my email, because I know I asked you some questions about my structure. So I definitely took some of those and to account and incorporated that in the emails as well. So
let me tell you a secret, Destiny. Mm-hmm. The reason all of you all are here right now is because back in the day when I was in your shoes, I did the exact same thing. I sent out, it felt to me like hundreds of letters. It was probably a dozen, but it felt like 100. And back then I had to type them up on a typewriter. So it wasn't just, you know, cut and paste like we can do now. Mm-hmm. And Destiny, not one single person responded to me.
Really?
Not one. Oh. Yes. So the reason we're here now, the reason I even do Live from the Pink Couch is because of that. Like, I was appalled that people would not take the time out to help others, especially those who look like them. And I just kind of vowed that if ever I had a chance to act as a mentor or now a coach, that I wouldn't turn anybody away who came to me, you know, for mentoring. So I say all of that to say, it's not unusual for people not to respond. What I didn't do that I do encourage you to do is to reach back out again.
Okay.
At least another 2 times over the course of a month, because people get busy, especially real estate people. They're in and out of office, right? Their office. So I would send a note and say, I just wanted to put this at the top of your inbox to make sure you had it. Because what I didn't hear you say, and maybe you did it, but I didn't hear you ask for a call to action. A call to action is, what do you want people to do once they receive your email?
Mm-hmm.
So did you ask them to do anything?
I did not. So that is probably a good point as to why they have not responded either.
Yeah, because you didn't ask them to do anything. Now.
Yes. I did not include that. I did go over my head. So I will do that in my next follow-up email. Yeah.
Yeah. So just resend an email saying, I wanted to make sure this was at the top of your inbox. I would really love the opportunity to chat with you and learn more about your agency and how new agents, entry-level agents factor in, if at all, with your company.
Okay.
That's what you want to ask them.
Sounds good.
Give a call to action. And then you have everybody's phone number?
Yes. Phone number and email.
Yes. So send them the email and say, I'd love to set up time to talk with you. I'll call you next Tuesday, Thursday, whatever. Give them a day when you're going to call them, because that may result in don't call me. It's one of those, don't call me, I'll call you kind of things. But it will probably prompt them, if they're receiving it, to respond back to you. Like, that's not a good time, Destiny. Don't call. Okay. That's better than no response at all.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay. So I'd really like to talk with you. I'm going to call you next Thursday, whatever, next Thursday at noon. And then you call them if you don't hear back from them.
Okay.
So, and then we probably need to practice what you're going to say when you call them. What you going to say, Destiny?
I would call them and I would let them know that I have reached out to them via email. I would let them know that this will be my second attempt, because I'm very eager to getting an informational interview. I kind of just put that together in my head. So does that sound okay?
Yeah, it sounds good. Say it nicely. Don't make it sound like this is the second time I have called you.
Oh, I would perfect it. I was just saying what I would say in the conversation, but yeah.
Yeah, okay. No, that sounds great. That sounds great. So Destiny, one of the other things you can do with the folks that you've emailed, one of the questions we had is, can Destiny reach out to those persons via LinkedIn?
Mm-hmm.
So that's a great suggestion. Reach out to them on LinkedIn. Sometimes people are more responsive on different platforms. Okay.
Sounds good.
All right, you guys, this is our next to last episode. So episode 6 is going to be all about you being ready to levitate to your next level.
and to meet those pink elephant goals. You're my hashtag next level tribe. I am counting on you. When you achieve your goal, we boot you out of the tribe. And that's a good thing, because it's always a good thing to get booted out of the tribe. We're probably not going to boot anybody out of the tribe for this season, simply because we only, we did it in 6 weeks versus the normal 12 weeks. And most of you have set long-term goals. And so we're cognizant of that, but I do want you to keep me posted as things happen to you. And if you have any questions about, well, what should I do now, Cheryl, just keep me posted on that. Even after next week, when we go into our live, our last episode. So the next episode, I want to know, this is homework assignment for all of you. I want to know how you're feeling now compared to episode one in terms of what's your confidence level. I want to know if you've learned anything, like what the number one or two things that you've learned from this experience, how has it been helpful to you? And, you know, what is your very next step after the last show? Because I don't want y'all not staying in action. So again, in case you're not writing this down, your homework assignment is to tell me what's different about you now compared to your first episode. What one or two things you learned from this process, and what you're going to do next after the last episode to stay in action. And, you know, and I always say this, and it's another Cheryl's Pink Couch tip: action is the antidote to despair. So whenever you get discouraged, or whenever you think, oh gosh, this is never going to happen for me, do something, stay in action, call somebody, get some help. Don't be afraid to ask for help, because that's what achieving our pink elephant goals, that's what living a life that we love involves. And sometimes you have to ask people for help. Any other questions? You guys are doing great. Okay. All right. So I'm going to see you all next week, and here live from the pink couch. I'm wishing you well, and hopefully you're going to spend this next week like really, really, really going full throttle to make sure you don't leave here not prepared for the future. Okay. All right. Y'all so quiet. Thank you.
Check out the progression of all of our participants at Cheryl's channel of Fabulosity on YouTube, or learn more about the coaching programs and services we offer at iamcherylgrace.com. This has been a Powerful Penny LLC Pink Elephant production.